see what I mean about the Cape having its own climate going on. And, half an hour down the road, the sun will be out again, it'll be a summer's day. But so that's the top of New Zealand, and I guess for a lot of you guys heading south, Bluff, that's the bottom of the South Island, so Cape to Bluff. If you've got spare 3 or 4 months of your life, and you're not doing anything, you can always walk it. It's one of the great walks of the world, apparently, Cape to Bluff. Really my thing. Doesn't ever move, I'm allergic to it. But yeah, those of you heading down to the South Islands, the first thing you'll notice, when you get into the South Island, you'll straight away you'll notice that it's completely different to the North Islands. Two very different land masses, it may as well be two different islands on the opposite ends of the planet. Both stunningly beautiful, but in different ways. South Island was formed as a result of two tectonic plates smashing into each other, and neither one giving in. So as a result, South Island is thrust up out of the depths of the ocean. That would be the Pacific Plate, the Indo-Australian Plate, and evidenced by the Southern Alps that run down the backbone of the South Island. The North Island, for a large part of North Island, actually, for the most part, it sits on the Australian plate, and you've got the Pacific plate subducted underneath it. And anywhere you have that scenario, you have extensive volcanism. The Cascadia Ranges, for example, up in the Pacific Northwest. So I've already mentioned that Auckland has more volcanoes per square area than any other place on the planet. Just south of Auckland, 3.5-4 hour drive, you have Phillip, which is the fifth largest super volcano on Earth. And the Phillip Lake, that was formed as a result of a series of eruptions that culminated in one gigantic eruption 27,000 years ago called the Pukenui. The lake itself is the same size as Singapore, about 800 feet deep. And to say that eruption was massive, I mean, okay, that's one thing, but to sort of quantify it so you can understand, all I can do is compare it to a relatively recent eruption, that would be Mount St. Helens back in 1980, up in Washington State. Now, Mount St. Helens was a large mountain, it's 10,000 feet, it was 10,000 feet. But within a couple of minutes, the whole side of it blew out. It was all caught on video. You can Google it, it's on YouTube. It's actually quite frightening. But as large as that eruption was, the Taupo eruption was 1,000 times larger. So that's, and scientists attribute that as one of the causes for plunging the Earth into its last ice age. But basically, it threw up so much ejecta into the upper atmospheres, the mesosphere, the ionosphere, troposphere, etc. that it blocked out the sun globally for quite a few years, and as a result, plunging the Earth into a nuclear winter, or in this case, a volcanic winter. The magnitude of Taupo is massive, it extends all the way north to Rotorua. Rotorua itself sits in a collapsed caldera, so next time when you go to Rotorua, have a look around you, and you see that Rotorua is ringed by a mountain range. That mountain range is actually what remains of the crater wall. The Rotorua sits inside a volcanic crater. That's evidenced by all the geothermal activity, you've got springs, hot mud pools, geysers, etc. And it also, the magma chamber of Taupo, it also extends out past about 20 to White Islands off the coast. White Islands is an active volcano in New Zealand. It's currently active. It's considered a pressure relief valve for Taupo. So the White Island has an event. It's a good thing because it's, well, I should be careful what I say, but it's all it means is it's letting off pressure from the Taupo caldera. Tragically, White Island did erupt back in 2019, and sadly there were three international start the bus, and if you're ready to go before that, we'll leave, but I'll start the bus at around that time, and we'll all start loading on. And head over to Nomal Beach on the west coast, sorry. We're currently on the west coast. On the east coast. So the cafe is straight through there, guys, to our left. Just go through the doors there. Just reverse up a bit. Locked in all the sand and grass that's growing over the top of it. what are we doing? We're on the beach. Look at that. I'm just giving a text to everyone else so they know that it's the tide. It's doable. Let's get on down. We might get the odd sweeper coming and make things a little tricky for us, but we'll see how we go. Alright, so welcome to 90 Mile Beach. If you guys want to come down and stand in the stairwell, not all at once of course, and film out the front window, you can do that. So, $1 million question, let's address the elephant in the room, shall we? Is it 90 miles long? The answer, no it's not. Next question, then why do you call it 90 mile beach? Next answer, because in Australia they have a beach that's 80 miles long.
And it is 80 miles.
And there's no way they can come second to the Aussies, mates. There's actually a little bit of truth to that. They, in Western Australia they have a beach that's called 80 Mile Beach, but in reality I think they have a beach that's 180 miles long, so yeah, we're never going to win that one. So the real length of it, the actual length of the beach is 60 miles at low tide, 55 at high. Okay, so there's more beach exposed at low tide obviously. So why do we call it 90 Mile Beach? Well, when it was originally charted, it was done so using the new metric system, which is kilometres, and we were by and large still using the old imperial system, which is miles. So when they wrote it down as 90 kilometres, we of course read it as 90 miles. That just sounds good, doesn't it, 90 miles? 90 kilometre beach. No, no, no. It doesn't quite have the same ring, does it? The other reason, which collaborates with the first, is Leroy said that they didn't have heavy machinery to drag the logs out of the forest. They had to rely on bullocks. And there's a bullock farm up the Cape Reinga. When they were ready for market, they were walking down 90 Mile Beach to Awanui, to the stockyards. And it was common knowledge that a bullock could walk roughly 30 miles a day. It took 3 days to walk down the beach. 3 times 30 is 90. But what they failed to realise is the weight of the beasts. It sank to the sand, didn't it? Slowed them down. They're only covering 20 miles an hour. 20 times 3, 60. There we go. So, 90 Mile Beach is classified as a legal highway in New Zealand. This is a highway. We are now driving on the world's oldest highway. About 80 million years old. And what happens every day, twice a day, is the Tasman Sea races ashore up to the sand dunes and then washes back out again, completely resealing it, which means we are currently driving on the world's youngest highway. It's less than an hour old. Giant seagulls off to our right, the black back gulls, twice the size of a regular seagull. They do a really cool thing actually. The waves expose pippies, which is a shellfish, and they'll pick them up in their beaks and they'll fly to about 50, 60 feet in the air and drop them on the wet compacted sand and smash them among them. So they can get to the shellfish inside. And you think about it, that's a really smart thing to do. The old saying of the bird brain, it's been sort of proven to be incorrect. I read something that I reckon a crow has the intellect of a 3-year-old human child. So directly to our right, guys, what do you reckon? I'll give you a hint. Starts with S. Anyone? Sea? Surf? Sand? Sky? Sharks? It's actually Shark Alley out there. It's my great original Sumatra and the Great White. Yeah, across the ditch there is Sydney, Australia. And if you're in Auckland, it's Melbourne. Melbourne. Any other takers to come down the front and film out the window?
Horses, seals, some of the seas of the Venus Fest. I need to
back then we were still able to call them by their third name, which was a ferry captain, but you're not allowed to call them that anymore. Just in case you might upset a little penguin who identifies as non-binary. Not only did you get it once, you snatched it out of the park twice.
Thank you.
make sure you have a good look around you, making sure you leave nothing behind. And yeah, thanks for coming along today, guys. Green rubbish bin underneath the tree just out there, that would be awesome.